गुड मॉर्निंग एचओडी प्रोफेसर ए के चतुर्वेदी सर, माय सेमिनार गाइड वीडी गिडवानी सर, सेमिनार कोऑर्डिनेटर डॉक्टर एस एस बोदारा सर, फैकल्टी मेंबर्स, एग्जामिनर्स एंड माय फ्रेंड्स. आई एम राहुल कुमार, पर्सुइंग माय बैचलर्स ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी इन एरोनॉटिकल इंजीनियरिंग फ्रॉम यूनिवर्सिटी डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ राजस्थान टेक्निकल यूनिवर्सिटी कोटा. टुडे आई एम गिविंग माय सेमिनार प्रेजेंटेशन ऑन टॉपिक विच इज री एंट्री ऑफ स्पेस व्हीकल. हियर इज द कंटेंट लिस्ट विच विल आई विल प्रेजेंट. री एंट्री फ्रॉम स्पेस, re-entry vehicles, history of re-entry vehicles, the shapes of re-entry vehicles, subsystem of re-entry vehicles and entry corridor, re-entry operation of space shuttle, terminal area energy management which is also called TAEM, recovery of space capsule, difference between space shuttle and space capsule, role of drag in re-entry, deceleration or aerodynamic heating, thermal protection system, re-entry disasters and last conclusion and then references. So, atmospheric re-entry. Atmospheric re-entry is the movement of an object from outer space into and through the gases of an atmosphere of a planet. Basically, re-entry is returning a spacecraft from space to Earth atmosphere or any atmospheric or non-atmospheric planet. There are two main types of atmospheric entry: uncontrolled entry and controlled entry. Basically, uncontrolled entry is such as entry of astronomical objects, space debris or meteoroid. And controlled entry or re-entry is known as entry of a spacecraft capable of being navigated or following a predetermined path. Aerodynamic re-entry. It is an extra type of re-entry. Aerodynamic re-entry of a space vehicle is a process where a spacecraft or a space vehicle re-enters the Earth atmosphere and uses its shape and the Earth atmosphere to decelerate and dissipate its kinetic energy. During aerodynamic re-entry, the spacecraft design is optimized to generate lift, which allows it to control its trajectory and glide through the atmosphere, and it also reducing the amount of fuel required for landing. Next is re-entry vehicles. Re-entry vehicles means a vehicle designed to return from Earth orbit or outer space to Earth substantially intact. The development of re-entry vehicles began in the late 1950s due to the need of Department of Defense and Central Intelligence Agency. There are mainly two types of re-entry vehicles: manned re-entry vehicles and unmanned. Basically, manned, these are vehicles designed to carry human crews and return them safely to Earth. Examples are NASA space shuttle, the Russian Soyuz spacecraft and the Chinese spacecraft. Unmanned re-entry vehicles. These are vehicles designed to deliver cargo, scientific experiment or other payloads to Earth, like the SpaceX, the Dragon spacecraft and the Russian Progress spacecraft. Re-entry vehicles can also be classified based on their re-entry trajectory. First is ballistic re-entry vehicle. This type of vehicle, a spacecraft enters the Earth atmosphere with a steep angle of descent, without attempting to generate lift or control its trajectory. During this re-entry, the spacecraft follows a high-speed, unpowered trajectory through the atmosphere using the Earth atmosphere as a braking medium to dissipate its kinetic energy and slow down. Next is lifting re-entry vehicles. These use wings or other aerodynamic surface to generate lift and control their descent. Examples, the space shuttle, the Russian Buran spacecraft. Next is the history of re-entry vehicles. The development of re-entry vehicles began in the late 1950s. There are many programs that describe the evolution of re-entry system development in the United States and foreign countries. First is Discover program. This program was of major importance because it provided a vehicle for testing orbital maneuvering capability and re-entry techniques, and it plays a large role in enabling the first United States manned space flight to be conducted in Project Mercury. The orbiting vehicle re-entry capsule was 7.62 meter long and 152.4 centimeter in diameter. Between 1959 and 1962, Vandenberg Air Force Base by the US Air Force, there are 38 launches which was conducted. After 1962, this type of work was classified. On February 27, 1962, resulted in 38 launches attempted, in which 26 spacecraft orbited, 23 attempted capsule recoveries, 8 successful air recoveries and 4 successful sea recoveries by satellite. And next is a biosatellite. This led 1960 NASA program directed by Ames Research Center and built by General Electric was intended to study the prolonged effects of weightlessness and radioactivity on living organisms. The agency planned 6 biosatellite flights, the first 2 with plants and second 2 with monkeys and third pair with rodents. The program was suspended after the third flight. The biosatellite consisted of a conical re-entry vehicle which contained the recovery capsule and a cylindrical adapter section. Next type of program is BOD Satellite Film Canister Re-entry System. Beginning in the early 1960s, the Air Force and the CIA began using re-entry capsules to retrieve film from satellites. The project was conducted under the codename Keyhole and successive satellite generations were given KH numbers that are still in use. The early programs Closed Look and the Area Survey ran concurrently from 1962 until 1964 with over 250 missions to their credit. On April 1961, Yuri Gagarin from the Soviet Union was the first human in space. His vehicle, Vostok 1, circled Earth at a speed of 27,400 km per hour, with the flight lasting 108 minutes. Vostok entry was controlled by a computer. Gagarin did not land inside of capsule. Instead, he ejected from a spacecraft and landed by parachute. On May 5, 1961, astronaut Alan Shepard returned to Earth after a suborbital flight aboard the Mercury Redstone 3 spacecraft. Next is the safe of re-entry vehicles. When any space vehicle returned from space enter into Earth atmosphere, there is a high aerodynamicity, which is enough for vaporize the space vehicle and also effect of drag. So safe of spacecraft is necessary for avoid this type of aerodynamicity. The first one is sphere or spherical section. Firstly, a spherical section safe is highly symmetrical, which helps the distribute heat evenly across the surface of the vehicle during re-entry. This is important because the heat generated during re-entry can be intense, reaching temperatures of several thousand degrees Celsius, and highly symmetrical shape can help to prevent any one area of the vehicle from becoming too hot. Next, a spherical shape offers a relatively low drag coefficient, which can help to reduce the vehicle's velocity during re-entry and prevent it from burning up or becoming damaged due to excessive heat. This is because a spherical shape generates less turbulence and friction as it moves through the atmosphere compared to other shapes such as cones or cylinders. Next, a spherical shape also provides a good volume to surface area ratio, which can be important for carrying payloads or crew members. By using a spherical section, the re-entry vehicle can have a large internal volume while still maintaining a compact and aerodynamic shape. And the last point is the Apollo command module used a spherical section 4 body heat shield with a converging conical upper body. In this slide, the image shows Apollo command module flying with the blunt end of the heat shield at a non-zero angle of attack in order to establish a lifting entry and control the landing site. See this image. Next, shape is spare cone. The spare cone is a spherical section with a frustum or blunted cone attached. The spherical section of a vehicle offers an excellent aerodynamic efficiency, while the conical section provides additional lift and helps to stabilize the vehicle during re-entry. It provides greater structural strength. The spherical section provides excellent structural strength, while the conical section allows for a more efficient use of materials and weight distribution, and it helping to reduce overall weight and improve maneuverability. Next point is the conical section of a vehicle provides greater control and stability. During re-entry, while the spherical section helps to maintain stability and prevent excessive heating or other stresses. The last point is the original American spare cone aerosol was the MK2 re-entry vehicle, which was developed in 1955 by the General Electric Corporation, which was an American company. In this slide, this image shows a prototype of MK2 re-entry vehicle and other images. And next image shows a Galileo probe during final assembly. Basically, Galileo probe was an American robotic space probe that studied the planet Jupiter and its moons. Next slide shows that biconic shape. The biconic is a spare cone with an additional frustum attached. The biconic shape allows for a more efficient use of thermal protection materials. And next point, the biconic shape provides good structural strength with a tapered design. The biconic shape provides a large payload volume than some other re-entry vehicle designs. The biconic offers a significantly improved lift and drag ratio. The most significant biconic flaw was the advanced maneuverable re-entry vehicle. Overall, the biconic shape is versatile design that provides a balance of aerodynamic efficiency, thermal protection, stability and control, structural strength, and the payload volume. In this slide, this image shows the DCX shown during this first flight. It was prototype single stage to orbit vehicle and used a biconic shape. Next shape is non-axis symmetric shape. These shapes have been used for crewed entry vehicles. One example is the winged orbiter vehicle that uses a delta wing for maneuvering during descent, much like a conventional glider. This approach has been used by the American Space Shuttle and the Soviet Buran. These are some space capsule with different shapes. And this image shows a successful NASA flight test on Monday, August 17, demonstrate how a spacecraft returning to Earth can use an inflatable heat shield to show and protect itself as it enters the atmosphere at hypersonic speed. The last one is inflatable shape. Inflatable shape is a type of shape for re-entry vehicles that is still in the experimental phase. It involves a vehicle that is made up of an inflatable structure that is covered in a heat-resistant material. The idea behind an inflatable shape is that it can be packed into a smaller space for launch and then inflated once in orbit, which can reduce the cost of launching and deploying the vehicle. Next topic is subsystem of re-entry vehicles. A re-entry vehicle is a complex system that is made up of many different subsystems, each with its own unique function and requirements. The first one is altitude and space control subsystem. This system normally is composed of sensors to stabilize the re-entry vehicle to maintain the re-entry vehicle orbital altitude. Next is deorbit propulsion subsystem. This system provides a required velocity decrement to deorbit the re-entry vehicle and place it on a trajectory that is aimed at the landing site. The structure is very necessary because structural design takes into the consideration, in addition to the loads imposed on any other satellite, the load imposed during deorbit, re-entry and landing. Next is power subsystem. The power source for the re-entry vehicle is a critical item, as with other satellites and typically a trade-off among batteries and types of batteries versus fuel cells versus solar power system. Next is power interface units, communication subsystem. Each payload normally has its own dedicated data and control system that controls payload function and collect and stores its data between re-entry vehicle to Earth communication period. The last is re-entry vehicle parachute subsystem. This system is designed to retard the re-entry vehicle's vertical velocity and provide a relatively soft touchdown. And the last one is re-entry thermal protection subsystem, which we will discuss in further slides. Next is entry corridor. An entry corridor is a range of entry conditions within which an entry is possible. There are mainly two types of entry corridor: guided entry corridor and unguided entry corridor. If we talk about guided entry corridor, in a guided entry, the spacecraft actively adjusts its trajectory during re-entry using propulsion aerodynamic control system. This allows the spacecraft to steer towards a specific landing site and adjust for any unforeseen changes in the atmosphere. And the next, unguided entry corridor, in this entry, the spacecraft follows a predetermined trajectory and relies solely on its aerodynamic shape and natural drag forces to slow down and reach its landing site. This type of entry is simple and less risky than guided entry corridor because it may not allow for precise targeting of the landing site. The choice of entry corridor type depends on several factors, including the spacecraft mission, objective, its design and capabilities, and the desired landing location. During re-entry a space shuttle mission, there are two types of boundary referred to the limits within which the shuttle is landing point must fall: overshoot boundary and undershoot boundary. In this first image, this green line shows a generic shuttle re-entry profile, and the shape of the line is influenced by some upper and lower boundaries. In blue, we have overshoot boundary, and in red, we have undershoot boundary. Because overshoot boundary would not destroy the orbiter, but we will potentially escape back out of the atmosphere with less than great prospects of a second re-entry attempt. Up above in red, we have got the undershoot boundary, generating too much drag. This is a hard boundary because crossing this boundary will cause damage to the orbiter by exceeding structural and thermal limits. The safe recovery of a spacecraft and its payload is made possible by the re-entry mission. According to the different constraints, the mission profile can be divided into three distinct flight segments: deorbit and descent to sensible atmosphere at an altitude of nearly 120 kilometers, re-entry and hypersonic glide flight, and last is transition flight phase, final approach and landing. The next topic is re-entry operation of space shuttle. There are many steps which will followed by during re-entry. First is pre-launch. Prior to launch, the payload is integrated into the re-entry vehicle and installation of some experiment, specimen and support equipment into the re-entry vehicle may be performed before the re-entry vehicle is mated to the launch vehicle. Next is orbit selection. For Earth atmospheric entry, of course, by convention at the Kármán line at an altitude of 100 km, which is 62 miles above the surface, the re-entry vehicle can operate in a variety of user-specified orbits or orbits specified by the requirement of a shared launch. And circular orbits within the altitude range of 350 to 900 km are normally used for re-entry. There are some other steps. Next step is deorbit burn. The space shuttle's engines are fired to slow the vehicle down and begin its descent back into the Earth atmosphere. And next, aerodynamic control. The shuttle is controlled using its wings and other control surfaces to maintain its orientation and trajectory during re-entry. And the second last basically landing approach. The shuttle makes its final approach to the landing site, typically a runway at the Kennedy Space Center and Edwards Air Force Base. Terminal Area Energy Management, which is also known as TAEM. TAEM is a critical phase of the space shuttle re-entry process. It refers to the management of the space shuttle energy during the final approach and the landing phase, which includes reducing its high speed and altitude to a safe level to land on the runway. During TAEM, the space shuttle pilot controls the vehicle's speed, altitude and glide slope to ensure a smooth landing. The process involves using a combination of shuttle engine, control surface and aerodynamic properties to reduce speed and altitude gradually. There are four main phases of terminal area energy management during the re-entry of space shuttle. The first one is entry interface. This is the point where the space shuttle first enters the Earth atmosphere. At this point, the shuttle is traveling at approximately Mach 25 and is about to 4 lakh feet above the ground. Next is heading alignment. During this phase, the shuttle maneuvers to align itself with the runway at the landing site. This is done using the reaction control system thrusters. Then final approach. During the final approach phase, the shuttle continues to lose altitude and speed and the landing gear is deployed. The shuttle uses a combination of RCS thrusters and the aerodynamic control surfaces to control its descent and maintain its alignment with the runway. At the end, flare and landing. In the final phase, the shuttle flares or pitches up to reduce its descent rate and touches down on the runway. The landing gear absorbs the impact of landing and the shuttle deploys its drag to slow down the further. Here is the video of re-entry of space shuttle in Earth atmosphere and done a proper landing. Next slide is recovery of space capsule. Once the capsule has landed, recovery teams move in to retrieve the astronaut and the capsule. Three retrieval methods have been used to recover re-entry vehicles: air snatch recovery, water recovery and land recovery. This is how crew recover space capsule from ocean. This is a part of water recovery. And this image shows land recovery of space capsule which is returning from space. Next is difference between space shuttle and space capsule. The re-entry of a space shuttle and a space capsule are two different processes with some significant differences. Here are some key point differences between the two space shuttle and space capsule. Vehicle size and shape.
space shuttle are much larger and have different shape than space capsules. The space shuttle is a wing vehicle that is designed to glide back to Earth like a plane, while space capsules are typically spherical or conical in shape and have a heat shield on the bottom to protect them during re-entry. Next is re-entry trajectory. The trajectory and the angle of re-entry for space shuttle and space capsule are different. This typically enter the Earth atmosphere at a shallow angle and glide back to Earth like a plane, while space capsules enter at a steeper angle and use their heat shield to slow down and protect the crew from the extreme heat. Launch and reusability. Space shuttles were designed to be launched and reused multiple times, while most space capsules are designed for a single use. Next is heat shield. Both vehicle heat shield used to protect them from extreme temperature generated during re-entry. However, the heat shield used by shuttles are typically made of ceramic tiles or other materials that are designed to be reusable, while capsules use a single-use ability heat shield that burns away during re-entry. Next is important topic is aerodynamic heating. The major concern of re-entry is to find a way to survive the aerodynamic heating. This obstacle was named as the thermal barrier. A vehicle approaching the Earth or a planetary atmosphere from space or from orbit possesses a large amount of kinetic energy. Due to its speed and potential energy by virtue of its position, this energy has to be dissipated and converted into heat to decelerate the vehicle to zero velocity and altitude. From speed of 8 km per second to energy per mass of 31.4 megajoule per kg must be dissipated. At high speed associated with re-entering from space, air cannot flow out of the way of the spacecraft fast enough. When the vehicle encounters the atmosphere, a shock will form ahead of the nose of the vehicle, hitting the atmosphere in the region to a very high temperature. Here is the video which shows how a spacecraft aerodynamic hit while re-entering. And the temperature is increased rapidly to several thousand degrees Celsius. Next is thermal protection system. TPS is the barrier that protects a spacecraft during the searing heat in atmospheric re-entry. A secondary goal may be to protect the spacecraft from the heat and cold of space field while in orbit. The TPS may also include thermal blankets, which are layers of insulating material that are placed between the heat shield and the spacecraft internal structure. The thermal conductivity of a particular TPS material is usually proportional to the material density. An ability heat shield is a material that is designed to absorb and dissipate the heat generated during re-entry by burning away in a controlled manner. If the spacecraft enters the atmosphere, the heat shield begins to burn and erode away, carrying the heat with it. The material that burns away takes the heat with it and keeps the rest of the spacecraft cool. And carbon fenolic is a very effective ability material, but also has a high density, which is undesirable. These are some basically thermal protection system and ability heat shield example. Super light weight ablator, phenolic impregnated carbon ablator, which is PICA, known as silicon impregnated reusable ceramic ablator, which is known as SIRCA Sirka, and thermal soap. Next is refractory insulation. These are basically tiles, and these tiles are used on the Boeing X-37 and in the Dream Chaser and SpaceX Starship design. It keeps the heat in the outermost layer of the spacecraft surface, where it is conducted away by the air. The temperature of the surface rises to this level, so the material must have very high melting point, and the material must also exhibit a very low thermal conductivity and the passively cooled thermal protection system. In some early ballistic missiles like Mk-2 and the suborbital Mercury spacecraft, radiatively cooled thermal protection systems were used to initially absorb heat flux during the heat pulse. This image shows the Mercury capsule design originally used a radiatively cooled TPS, means a thermal protection system, but was later converted to an ablative TPS. And the next slide is the re-entry disaster. because we know returning from space is more dangerous process comparing to going into space. So there are some disaster which will happen during re-entry. The first is Space Shuttle Columbia disaster. It happened in 2003. During re-entry, the shuttle broke apart due to damage sustained during liftoff when a piece of foam insulation fell off the external tank and struck the wing on strut. On February 1, 2003, Space Shuttle Columbia disintegrated as it re-entered the atmosphere over Texas and killing all 7 astronauts on board. In this team, our Indian astronaut Kalpana Chawla was dead. Next is Soyuz. The Soviet Union first manned mission ended tragically when astronaut Vladimir Komarov died during the capsule's return Earth due to parachute failure and impact with the ground. Next is Progress M27M. This happened in 2015. The unmanned cargo spacecraft experienced a malfunction during re-entry, resulting in its controlled descent and destruction during atmospheric re-entry.
Now this is the conclusion. In the design of a practical manned re-entry system, it is necessary to accomplish two things. The first is to bring the re-entry acceleration down to levels well within the human endurance, and the second is to limit the maximum heating rate and total heat plus to less than material limits. And re-entry at high total angle of attack provides a reduction in both maximum heating rate and total heating encountered. And last is the references, and thank you.